Hello and welcome to My Secret Math Tutor. In this video, we're going to cover some of the basic rules for indefinite integrals. Now, before we get too far, there's one big important thing we really need to point out, and that's know the difference between the types of integrals that are out there. In this video, we're going to specifically cover indefinite integrals, but there are integrals called definite integrals. And, you know, I'll be covering those in a different video. And the biggest difference that you can really spot with these is that you'll see numbers right next to the integral symbol. So those are handled differently. We think of those as an area, but again, we'll cover those in a different video. Let's just focus on the basics, the indefinite integrals. Now, when it comes to these, the good news is there's only a few simple rules that you really have to keep in mind. And probably the biggest rule that you really want to keep in mind is that with these indefinite integrals, you're really thinking of an antiderivative. So you're trying to work backwards to figure out, if I was to take the derivative of this function, what would I get? And oftentimes you'll see notation for an antiderivative simply use a capital letter. So what this is trying to say is that I'm starting with some sort of function, I'm working backwards, and its antiderivative is now over here, which I'm calling capital F. These antiderivatives will also involve a plus C or a constant. And that's because when we're taking the antiderivative, it may have some sort of constant component, but usually the derivative wipes that out, so we're not even sure what that is. Now, this is probably the biggest thing you have to keep in mind, but there are a few other things that are good about antiderivatives or indefinite integrals, and that's they have a sum and difference rule. So if you have two functions that are added or subtracted, then you're simply taking the antiderivative of each of those and adding and subtractive respectively. If you have a constant multiplied out front, feel free to pull out that constant, then you can just worry about taking the antiderivative of the function that's left on the inside. All right, so there's not a whole lot of rules, and that's kind of a nice thing, so there's not a whole lot to remember. Let's go ahead and jump into some examples and see how they play out. So for the first of these, I'm gonna look at the indefinite integral of 3x to the fourth power, and I could also say I'm just simply looking for the antiderivative of 3x to the fourth. All right, so the biggest thing you wanna think of is, you know, if I was to start with a function and take its derivative, then it would turn into this. And to really get good at that process, you have to start really knowing your derivatives. So for example, I might start playing around saying, okay, when I take derivatives, I bring down the power and I reduce it by 1. So if I was doing that, I think this power must have been 5. You know, that'd be the only way that I could reduce it and it would end up as 4. So in going in the other direction, I would think of like adding 1 to the power. All right, now the 3 is a constant, so I'm not going to worry about that. In fact, it's just going to hang out for a bit. And let's see, what should have been out front? You know, I'm gonna say that that is a 1/5, and then we'll put our constant. So it's a really big process to think backwards like that, but let's go ahead and check. So if I was to take the derivative of this, you know, derivatives, they also are not affected by these constants out front, but I would bring down the power, it'd cancel out the 5, and this would be reduced by 1, turning it into 4. So sure enough, we see that our antiderivative is 3/5 x to the fifth power plus some sort of constant. And this is what we would have for the indefinite integral. All right, let's try this again with another example. This one I'm gonna try and walk through a little bit more just so we can see what's going on here. So if you see a constant and it's not being multiplied by anything, you can consider it to be a variable with a power of 0. All right, so here's a cosine of x dx. And again, we want to think backwards. So I'm thinking about this power, let's see, I will add 1 to the power, so 0 plus 1 is 1. And then I'm going to end up dividing by this new power, so 4 divided by 1 is simply 4, so that looks pretty good. Moving on to cosine, what function's derivative would equal cosine? Well, that would have to be sine. Of course, we put a plus C on the end. I could clean this up a little bit and just say this is 4x minus sine of x plus a constant, and that would be my antiderivative. So you'll notice that one thing that can make this a much easier process is knowing your derivatives really, really well. The more derivative rules you have in your back pocket, the better you'll be able to recognize your antiderivatives and be able to move in that direction. One of the biggest, though, is probably this power rule for derivatives. And the way you're going to see it show up for antiderivatives is when you have something like x to a power, you're going to add 1 to the power and then divide by that new power. So it's exactly like the usual power rule, but it's, you know, doing opposite things. It's adding 1 to the power, it's dividing by the new power. And of course, you saw me use that in a couple of the last examples. The more of these derivative rules you know, again, the better this will be. So know your trigonometric rules, know your inverse trigonometric rules, know all of those. All right, let's get into another example and see some things that can make this go a little bit better. Now, with this one, you have to be really careful how you apply your antiderivatives, how you work backwards, because, you know, I have something divided by something else, but if you think all the way back to those rules for indefinite integrals, they said nothing about division. So for problems like this, sometimes it's best to actually start rewriting them. And in some of my derivative videos, this was also a handy technique. You know, if you just change what it looks like, sometimes you can handle it fairly quickly and use the rules that you actually have. So far I've just split this up into two fractions. It looks a little strange, but it is a valid rule. You know, if we were to put these together, I'd make sure they have the same denominator, and sure enough, we'd end up back over here. Now let's see, moving on, I might look at this instead of a square root, I would say this is like x to the 1/2. What I'm going to end up doing here is I want to reduce these powers. And so let's see. If I want to reduce this first power, I'd subtract the 1/2 from the 2. Let's see, 2 - 1/2, I'd be left with 3/2. And here, since there's no x's in the top, I can just consider this a negative exponent, so plus x to the negative 1/2. So notice we have not taken the antiderivative. I haven't even thought about that process yet. I've really just gone through a process of manipulating this so that I can start using some more of my rules, and now we can actually use that rule of adding 1 to the power and then dividing by the new power. So let's go ahead and do that. So I'm going to take my x, we're going to take the power that it is now, we're going to add 1 to that new power, and whatever new number this is, we're going to divide by it. So of course we have some work to do. That's what's going to end up over there. And we've got to do the same thing for this one. So negative 1/2 plus 1. And we're going to divide this by whatever new number we get. All right, so that looks pretty good. We should probably put a plus C in there. And let's go ahead and clean this up. So 3/2 plus 1, that would equal x to the 5/2. So that's going to be this number down here, 1 divided by 5/2. And let's see, x to the 1/2, so negative 1/2 plus 1, 1/2, and that's this number down here. It looks a little messy, and of course we should probably clean this up. When we divide by a fraction, we want to flip and multiply, so let's go ahead and think what this is really doing. So this is 1 divided by 5/2, or we can think of it as 1 multiplied by 2/5. So this expression becomes 2/5. Multiplied by x to the 5/2, plus, we'll do the same thing here, this will be a 2, x to the 1/2, and we have our plus constant. Okay, so I had to really manipulate this thing so that I was only using the antiderivative of things that were added together, and in this case, just using a power rule to add 1 to the power and reduce it. Now be very, very careful when you're doing antiderivatives. These are the most common mistakes that people will do. Sometimes you have two functions that are multiplied together and people will try and take the indefinite integral of each of those. This is not a valid rule. In fact, you're gonna handle that later on using something, a different rule for these antiderivatives. You'll get into like U substitution and stuff like that. Another one is what looks like a chain rule. If you have a function inside of another one, people will try and take the antiderivative of the outside and the antiderivative of the inside, but again, that is not a valid rule. You'll usually take care of those using something like U substitution, okay? And of course, the biggest rule that, or not necessarily rule, but the biggest problem that some people have with antiderivatives is even a very simple function might not have a closed form for the antiderivative. That means when I try and write down the formula or just write down what the antiderivative is, it's not going to be as simple as you think it is. It's not going to be a single finite formula that actually describes what's going on. So this one happens to be one of those that does not have a closed form. Even though it looks really simple, you'll probably have to wait until a little bit later in calculus to see what this guy's antiderivative is, and it's going to involve an infinite amount of functions, so be careful for those. All right, let's get back to some ones that we can do, or at least ones that, you know, it looks like maybe we can't do them, but again, if we manipulate them just right, we have all the tools that we can actually take an antiderivative. All right, let's try this guy out. So here I have x to the fourth minus 1, and all of that's being squared. And some common mistakes might be to try and add 1 to this power, divide by 3, and continue on from there. But we really have another function inside of that, okay? So we have to be a little bit more careful. We want to think of manipulating this first. I'm just going to spread this out. So this is x to the fourth minus 1 multiplied by x to the fourth minus 1. And I'm doing this so that I can expand it out into a whole bunch of functions that are added. Then we'll go ahead and take care of those. All right, so let's keep expanding. X to the fourth times x to the fourth, we'll add those exponents. Outside will be minus x to the fourth, inside minus x to the fourth. Last terms, minus 1 times minus 1, plus 1. And let's go ahead and combine the common terms from here. So x to the eighth minus 2x to the fourth plus 1. Okay, that's all good. Now that it's all spread out, now I can worry about actually taking this antiderivative. And of course, we'll just use a power rule. So starting with the first one, 8 plus 1 is 9. We'll divide by that new power. 4 plus 1 is 5. We'll divide by that new power. The 2 will still be there. And this one, it looks like I don't have an x, so we'll just consider that as x to the 0. We want to add 1 to that power, so we'll get x to the first power. And just to make sure we're on the same page, let's put a plus c. There's the proper indefinite integral. All right, now as a big challenge to this, we're going to do just one more example, but this last one really shows you why it's important to know all of your derivatives. This one, you know, when you're first doing indefinite integrals, looks pretty tricky because we don't have any rules to take care of division, and we only got so many limited things to do for trigonometric functions. But check this out, okay? This first expression is really a special type of derivative. In fact, it's the derivative for inverse tangent. And over here, this guy is the derivative of just regular old tangent. So in other words, what I'm trying to say here is if I took this guy's derivative, I would get this. If I took tangent's derivative, I'd get secant squared. And since antiderivatives, this indefinite integral works backwards, these are the two expressions I'd get. So I'd get arctangent plus tangent. And of course, our plus constant. So even though it looks pretty scary looking, and it looks like we might not have any rules to take care of it, it's all about knowing your derivatives, and you'll be just fine. All right. Thanks for watching this video. Please check out some of my other calculus videos. I'll be doing more about integration in just a little bit, but hopefully this gets you started with some indefinite integrals. Thank you for watching.